Everyone, good afternoon. My name is Ben Vinson. I am the Provost and Executive Vice President of Case Western Reserve University. I want to thank all of you for joining us this evening and welcome to our third installment in our North Star Seminar Series. Now, if you've joined us for one of our previous events, then you know why we're here today. But for those of you who are first timers with us, please let me allow you to tell us a little bit about the university and about what we're trying to do with this series. At Case Western Reserve University, we are driven by a vision that we call our North Star. It states that Case Western Reserve is a high impact research university that aspires to be a community where humanity, science, and technology meet to create a just and thriving world. Now, to help further that mission, we highlight diverse people, diverse opinions, diverse ideas, but always with the goal of engaging in a dialogue that is civil and respectful. Now, in the series that you're engaging in with us today, this North Star Seminar Series, we're doing just that. We need conversations like this one today. We need to keep civil discourse and learning alive in our institution and in our community. And we're delighted that you've decided to join us in this mission. Now, today we have our distinguished guest for only about 45 minutes, so we're going to jump right into the program, but I also hope to leave at least 10 minutes today for questions and answers from all of you in the audience. So I will ask you, though, to hold your questions until the end, and we look forward to hearing your thoughts. You will feel free to begin to populate the chat room, though, if you'd like to start getting a head start on those questions as you hear our speaker. Before we move on, I do have some people to thank. I want to thank our partners on this event, and that includes the Case Western Reserve University's College of Arts and Sciences Military Ethics Program, as well as Cuyahoga County Public Library. We couldn't do this event without you. We're so incredibly grateful to the way you support this event, but also the way you serve our community in so many different ways. Again, thanks for your support and for encouraging civic dialogue in our greater community. I also want to acknowledge the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, their recent report and the commission on Our Common Purpose, Reinventing American Democracy for the 21st Century. This has been a catalyst for us in designing this seminar series. It's now a pleasure for me to introduce today's guest. The Honorable Gil Cisneros is a philanthropist and former politician who served as the United States Representative for California's 39th Congressional District from 2019 to 2021. Gil is the son of a public school cafeteria worker and a celebrated Vietnam veteran, and he attended college on a Naval ROTC scholarship. He graduated with a bachelor's degree in political science from the George Washington University, and he holds an MBA from Regis University and a Master of Arts in Urban Education Policy from Brown University. Through 10 years of service as a United States Naval officer, Gil was awarded the Navy Commendation Medal, the Navy Achievement Medal, the National Defense Medal, and the Armed Forces Expeditionary Medal for his exemplary service to our country. Gil is the Veterans Education Advocate and co-founder of the Gilbert and Jackie Cisneros Foundation. This is an organization committed to strengthening public schools in creating college opportunities for students and veterans. He also served on the advisory board of Michelle Obama's Reach Higher Initiative for College Access. Gil's dedication towards philanthropy began when he purchased a winning California Mega Millions lottery ticket in 2010. Gil and his wife, Jackie, partnered with the Hispanic Scholarship Fund and the city of Pico Rivera, California, to create Generation First Degree Pico Rivera, with the goal of putting a college degree in every household in the city. Gil has worked to strengthen schools and promote access to quality education by supporting yellow ribbon programs for veterans, establishing scholarships, and creating an endowment for the dependents of former Navy Supply Corps personnel so that tuition costs are never a barrier to educational opportunities. Gil is a hero to our nation. He is a hero to education, and he's a champion for all. Without further ado, I'm pleased to welcome my friend, the Honorable Gil Cisneros. Gil?
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that very much, Ben. I don't know if I would call myself a hero, but I do like the idea of me being a champion for those that have been less fortunate to work to uplift people and really give them an opportunity like other people had given me in my life. And I know that's what you're doing over there at Case Western University. So thank you very much for everything that you're doing there. And really thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak with you and your audience. You know, welcoming a former member of Congress from California to kind of talk about, you know, what's going on in the world and really a little bit about myself. So thank you very much for having me.
Gil, it's a pleasure. And I've got to say, you're bringing sunshine our way. Today's a bright day here in Cleveland. We were in the green room. We were just talking with Gil. He's watching the boats watching the water from where he's sitting right now. So just for those of us here in Cleveland who are looking at snow outside, although it's melting, just to set the scene a little bit for you. Thanks, Gil, for being here. To help me moderate this discussion this afternoon and to lend another voice to today's talk, I really want to welcome my esteemed colleague, Dr. Peter Shulman. Professor Shulman, now, he studies technology, science, and American politics in the 19th, 20th, and 21st centuries. And his special interests include the history of energy, environmental history, communication and transportation, the history of intelligence, the history of American foreign relations, and just about every other history you can imagine. This guy he's got it all. He teaches the history of technology, energy, and environment right here at Case Western Reserve, as well as historical methods and contemporary history. His first book, Coal and Empire, a page-turner, The Birth of Energy Security in Industrial America, it explored how Americans came to think of energy in terms of national security, not around oil in the 20th century, but coal in the 19th century, and how the construction of an overseas American empire transformed the American approach to energy infrastructure. And that's in terms of foreign relations, naval strategy, and technological networks. Now, his current book projects are a history of American conservation before the conservation movement, and a history of ideas about intelligence, in 20th century America. Professor Shulman currently serves as chair of the Faculty Senate Committee on Undergraduate Education, and he has been a champion as well of general education reform here at the university and a magnificent partner in helping us navigate through the pandemic. I'm pleased to welcome my colleague, Peter Shulman.
Thank you, Provost Vinson, for that very kind introduction. I look forward to our conversation with Congressman Cisneros. I just want to start off by saying, you know, the thoughts I'm bringing to this conversation are it's been a brutal year between the pandemic, between this contentious election that we've had, and really the kind of accumulated experiences over the past 5 years of you know, debates that have reignited some of the most dark corners of our society around race, around immigration, sex and gender and sexuality. It's been a very divisive period and a very, I think, unpleasant period for a lot of Americans. I'm a historian, so I'm interested in kind of thinking about contemporary events in a longer historical context. I teach a course, when I think about contemporary history, I teach a course for our first year students called The History of Your Lifetime, the past 18 years of history. Mm-hmm. This is history that our students have lived through, but they never learned about it in school. And they may have experienced it as children and not really been able to kind of think about it as adults may have. And they never really have a chance to kind of learn this kind of material from a scholarly perspective. So that's what I'm interested in doing. It's interesting this year, the first time I've taught the class, I had to kind of cut off 9/11 because our first year students were born after 9/11, which had been long been a topic that we covered in the course. But I'm interested in pluralism, right? Our society is a complex, lots of different groups, different people, different kinds of associations that we have, different identities that we have. Some overlap, some don't. How do we operate a society with all of these, with this great diversity of this country? And we see issues that we face: wealth inequality, climate change, racial injustice, the role of the United States in the world. How do we ask questions and try to solve these kinds of problems if we can't have dialogue, if we can't have debate, if we can't have a public sphere that's conducive to finding common ground in this rich pluralistic society? So I look forward to exploring some of these issues today, and thank you again for having me.
Peter, thank you so much for joining us. And it's a pleasure. And I think we should dive right in. Gil, Talk to us about your journey into Congress. Why did you decide to run?
You know, it was never something that I really inspired to do or really thought that I would do. I knew I always wanted to serve my country, and that was something that I thought I would do through the military, and that's what I did at 18. I right out of high school, I joined the Navy. Was very lucky enough to meet some people who saw something more in myself than I, well, saw something in me than I saw in myself, and inspired me to go on to college. And that pretty much changed my life. And, you know, the way that I thought I would serve would be kind of like what we were doing, like you said, right? We were started our foundation. We were helping kids. We were trying to uplift people and really kind of give them that same opportunity that I had through college. But I think after the 2018 election, I saw that we needed people in Congress that spoke with a voice that was going to be there to kind of go and help, to be there to help uplift people, right? To give our students a voice, to give our veterans a voice. And that was really one of the reasons why I decided to run. And I was successful in 2018. Unfortunately, I wasn't successful in my reelection here in 2020. But I think that was one of the things that inspired me to do this and really inspired me to run in a district that has pretty much been, as a Democrat, it had been a long time Republican district. I mean, my predecessor was a Republican, had been there for about over 26 years. You know, his predecessor before him was a Republican, had been over there for, I think was there for about 13 years. And so it really has been a long time Republican area that I was able to win in with some of these ideas. And unfortunately, we weren't able to kind of keep that momentum going into the thing. But I think people still want those leaders there in Congress that are going to speak up for those, that are going to help uplift people, that are going to speak up for our veterans, speak up for our students, speak up for those individuals that don't have a voice or aren't heard that often, and give them that voice to make sure that they're not forgotten.
Well, Gil, I've got to say, I think you are remarkably modest in saying, you know, that you didn't win this time. I mean, I was watching the results. It was a nail biter. That was down to the wire. And the first one was down to the wire. I think, if I remember correctly, I think the person who lost in that election was on her way to Washington, and then you won. And, I mean, you are at the reason why we really value you coming here. You're at the front lines, right? In one of those states that, and one of those districts that really at the cusp, it can go either way. And you're the focal point in many ways of a very important conversation happening in our country. You know, it raises a question for us. What is the state of civic dialogue in California? And you have been in one of the most contentious congressional races in America. You know, what did you learn about improving civic dialogue in a climate like that?
You know, it's in Congress, you know, you always hear a lot about like how, well, each side isn't talking to each other, right? They're not getting along. You know, unfortunately, the bad thing about Congress is that what's happened to it, it's kind of since the early 90s when Newt Gingrich was there and kind of brought in his contract with America, the thing that he told Republicans was there was like, don't spend time in Washington, go back to your districts. And the one thing that happens in Washington, if one side does it, the other side follows. And it doesn't matter who does it first. So we got away from this area or this time where members of Congress used to spend a lot more time in Washington. They would get to know each other, their families lived there. You know, their wives would know each other, and it kind of went across the aisle. Their kids would play Little League together or do gymnastics or other sports. But now most members of Congress, their families stay back home. They don't live in Washington. You don't really have a lot of time to kind of build that civility amongst knowing like your other members there, or your other colleagues there, not only across the aisle, but, you know, even in your own party sometimes, you know, and there are 435 members, so it is kind of hard to get to know everybody there. and to get to know them well. And so I think that it's kind of caused a lot of this reaction where a lot of people don't really kind of there, and it doesn't seem like they're not civil. But I think for the most part, right, people are agreeable, right? And you can talk to them and you can build, you know, some friendships, not deep, you know, friendships with people. But, you know, you try and you do this, right? And you try and do this across the aisle, but it's harder and harder. And right now it's even harder. Because I think right now they're spending basically 2 weeks in Washington, 2 weeks back in their districts. There's not like a lot of time for them to come together to meet and to speak and to talk, to talk about issues or to talk about other things, or even just kind of ask each other like, hey, how you doing? Because now when they're in Washington for the 2 weeks at a time, it's all like go, 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 go. And then it's like, now you're back home. And then when you're in the district, it's always go, 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 go. And so there isn't time to build that relationship. And I think it's caused some of that, you know, what seems like it's not civil there in Congress, and it's hurt. And I think you've kind of seen that kind of happen across the country, right? As politically we've become more polarized, it's spread out into the public and to different parts of, you know, the country where it doesn't really matter, like, what you do or how you do it or how well you serve them. If you're not in the right party or you don't have this right belief, then people aren't going to support you. And I told this story, and I will tell everybody this story right now. You know, we had an individual who called our office, and the one thing that where I always knew where we can make a difference was with, you know, constituent services. How can we help the people of our district? So we always return phone calls. We always reply to your emails. And we had this individual, a veteran, who had called us regarding some of his, he wasn't getting his veterans benefits and he needed help. And so we helped him out and got him what he needed and what he was asking for. But he actually knew a friend of mine that I become friends with though, as the member of Congress. And he told me the story about how he goes, man, you know, he called, I didn't expect the help that we got. They actually helped me out and got me what I needed. But I just wish he was a Republican so I could vote for him. And that's really kind of, I think, for a lot of people that what it's like right now. You know, I had another a guy who's actually become a friend of mine, a Republican, who, you know, we provide him services and help to his business when he was looking, he was making surgical gowns and trying to get them out during this pandemic when it all started, when we were hearing about shortages. And he's like, look, can you help me connect? So we help connect him with the VA so he can get these things sold. And, you know, he's a friend now. It's somebody, and there is that kind of civility, right? We can still build these friendships. But I think for others, you're always going to have that people. It's like, oh, you're in the wrong party, or you don't agree with me 100%. So I just can't support you.
Gil, thanks for that. I think I want to pass it over to Peter to shed some great insights with his penetrating questions. Peter?
Thank you, Ben. I actually just want to follow up briefly. That this reminds me, I think it was back in 2006 when I was living in Rhode Island. And I think that was the year when Sheldon Whitehouse was running against Lincoln Chafee in the Senate race. And Chafee was very popular moderate Republican. He was the son of the former holder of that seat. And one of Whitehouse's campaign ads was basically saying, we know you like Lincoln Chafee. He's a nice guy, but think about control of the Senate. It's not about the individual. It's about which party is going to be in control, which ended up being a compelling argument, but it took away from, you know, the complexity of, you know, who would you want to vote for, you know, for their own representation of the state versus what's in the kind of national interest of, you know, of the collective party. And those things tend to collide. But I wanted to follow up here on, you know, you're from California, 39th district. This is, I think, for those of you who aren't deeply familiar with California, this is kind of part of greater Los Angeles, Orange County, part, you know, that area. California is sometimes seen as a model for the future of the rest of the country, right? More diverse, more liberal, more active in its state and local government. And this is either an encouraging vision or a nightmarish vision, depending on your perspective. I'm not sure, what do you think? Is this view correct? Is California a model for the future of the rest of the country? And either way, what does today's politics in California have to teach us about the future of the rest of the country?
Well, I think in California, we like to think of ourselves as, a model. We kind of have a saying that as California goes, the country goes. And like you said, some people are probably cringing at the sound of that. But, I think when you think about things, right, what we have done, and I'll give you the automobile, for example, right? California's emissions are a little bit more stricter than a lot of other parts of the country. And a lot because of those requirements on the vehicles that we have here in the state of California, it's caused all the automakers to kind of make their automobiles up to California standards. And rather than having to make two separate vehicles, one for California and one for the rest of the country. And I think that's a way that we've been able to kind of lead here, right? And I think, right now the largest growing industry sector right here in California is renewable energies. We know that's the future of the country. We know that's the future of the economy. And right now, I think we're trying to lead in that way and kind of trying to show it because we know that it'll be an example to the rest of the country. And I think it's, despite what the negativity that you heard, the incorrect things that you heard about Texas, about how some of the renewable energies were really the fault, we know that's not true. We know that's the future. We know it's going to be better for our planet. We know it's going to be better for our economy. And this is really where we're investing right now. And we think we'll see that investment in the rest of the country later on.
Peter, do you mind if I interject with another question?
Go for it.
Well, thank you. Gil, if I can just transition a little bit, because one of the things here that's important for us is we're at a university and we're trying to also grapple with our role as a university to help in bridging some of these divides and some of the stridency in the dialogue right now. And, we know that you have been a great friend of education. You founded a Hispanic Leadership Institute at George Washington University. And, what do you think, having spent time in Congress, having really been at the cutting edge here in one of these very difficult districts, really, really bridging and healing, what do you think universities should do to develop citizen leaders in order to help us achieve a better civic dialogue here in the United States?
Well, I think that's part of a university's mission. And first, let me say thank you. You talked about how we founded the Hispanic Leadership Institute. We wouldn't have been able to do that without your help and support when you were at George Washington before you came here to Case. So thank you very much for that. But I think it should be the mission of every university, right? To create and to make citizens and to go out and educate people and so that they can be productive members of society and really go out there and make a difference. And that's not just about conforming to the way things are, but to have people that are going to go out there and ask questions and challenge the system and be ready to get out there and to make a difference. I think that's important. And I think we need that. There are times, and we've been seeing this that I think at a lot of universities around the country where, we talk about, hate speech and really trying to minimize that and we do want to stop the hate speech, right? But sometimes we need to hear the other voices out there that are speaking. And I think that helps us formulate our opinions to really know what's right and what's wrong. And, it's happened out here in California. The Berkeley is like one of the schools that kind of comes to mind where they've prevented, people from going there and speaking. You're not always going to agree with everybody, but I still think it's very important that you need to hear those individuals. And I think colleges and universities across the country need to play a role in that in helping individuals hear those voices, especially their students, so they can go out. Like I said, I think that's part of creating and forming those individuals to go out and become citizens, and not just citizens, but good citizens out there, and that'll be productive and be able to ask those tough and hard questions.
Thank you. Peter?
Yeah, if I could follow up there, if my numbers are correct, you've contributed tens of millions of dollars towards education, mm-hmm. which is just incredible. And I'm wondering, what do you hope to see from those efforts? Like what in terms of your investments, your philanthropy, what would make you feel like your money has been well spent?
You know, I think for me, it's about creating a more diverse society, right? And look, our country is becoming more diverse. We're seeing that, you're going to see this in the census that's coming up. But, you know, our population is definitely becoming more diverse. Our schools and the public schools are becoming more diverse. One of the reasons why we started the Leadership Institute, the Hispanic Leadership Institute, was to try and encourage individuals of color, Latinos, to go and to challenge themselves to get into these areas where it's not quite so diverse yet. And really one of those areas are colleges and universities. And as you get up to the more elite universities, the number, they become less diverse. And so it was really about kind of encouraging individuals and letting them know that, hey, there are other windows out there. There are other doors that can be open for you to let you, that you can walk through, to think bigger, because you're doing the work. You know, you are putting in the effort. You are doing the work. We need to help you get into these doors to encourage you in order so that you can go to these elite universities, so that you can go into these industries. You know, both of you have PhDs. The number of minorities that PhD is just, I think it's less than 2%. And you can correct me if I'm wrong on that, but, you know, it's very small. How do we encourage more students to get into these programs, right? How do we encourage them to become doctors and lawyers, to go into Wall Street or to become, you know, history professors? This was part of what we want to do, right? And why everything that we've done with the money that we put into education is about trying to uplift individuals, to give them that opportunity so that they can realize that there's something better for them. You know, I say this all the time, nobody ever gets anywhere alone. And I think, you know, throughout our lives, we've all had a mentor, or somebody that looked out for us, or somebody that encouraged us, or somebody that, you know, said, you should think about this. And really, that's what we've been trying to do with our philanthropy, is to help students recognize that they can do more than they're dreaming about.
I've got to applaud all of that. And for those of us in higher education, we deeply appreciate your model and the way you think about these questions and really access. I think that's really important at this moment in time. We probably have time for about two more questions. Probably one quick one from me, one quick one from Peter. We're going to open it up to the audience. So I encourage now the audience to, if you want to start putting something in the chat room, start thinking about your questions. I'm going to throw one more question at you, Gil, and then I'm going to pass it over to my colleague, Peter, to give you one more, and then we'll open it up. For me, I'm going to go back to that theme. Dialogue, healing in a time of strife in our conversation. Was there anything in particular, and now I'm going to take it back to your days in Congress, during the Trump years that you learned that really can help our country heal? Anything that you saw during those times that you think we can pick up on? If you had a telegraph or a way to message, instant message your everyone in Congress right now, with something that you saw that will move us forward. What do you see, Gil?
You know, again, right, and I'll talk about this, you know, I already kind of mentioned this, right? In the media, you hear a lot about how people aren't talking and everybody's, you know, one side or the other. And that is not the case at all. I think what happens in Washington is that you get a lot of people at the extremes who are making the loudest noise. They get all the attention. And a lot of the work is being done in the middle by people who aren't creating a lot of noise. And there are people there working together. And it's about kind of, I think, coming together, finding those bipartisan issues that we can work together to move the country forward. You know, when I was in Congress, I was part of a bipartisan caucus called the For Country Caucus. It was all veterans, Republicans and Democrats, working together on issues. You know, issues to help our Department of Defense, our veterans, issues to help our veterans. You know, one of the big things that we were working towards was a national program for national service. And how do we get people involved in national service to go and to really go out and try and make a difference, right, to help others? And I think these are issues where we can kind of come together and work. It's about finding those core issues, right, where we can get along and moving forward. I think, you know, and in the middle, right, there is a tendency when you're doing this, right, you're going to start listening to the other issues where maybe you don't have so much agreement on, and about finding those areas where you can move forward. You know, I think we can do this, but, you know, the problem with, I think, with Washington is you do hear a lot is that there are individuals out there who do not want to compromise, and it's on the left and it's on the right, and it has to be our way or you know, no way at all. And that is something that we've got to get away from. You know, there are so many different caucuses, whether it's, you know, whether it be the Freedom Caucus or the Progressive Caucus. You know, they have enough people in these caucuses where they can actually stop something from going forward, from stopping the legislation. I think we got to work more towards these caucuses in the middle and kind of let them take the voice and let them kind of speak up and really let, you know, work with them to kind of go and because they're going to be the ones that bring the two sides together that can go so that we can move legislation forward, so that we can get things done, so we can find these issues where people where people want it together. And one of the issues that I will say is like common sense gun legislation. HR 8 was a bill that we passed, and it's going to come again. I'm pretty sure it's going to have the same number, HR 8, which was background increasing background checks, which is something over 80% of the country want. You know, and this is what we need to do, is we need to listen to them, the people in the middle there, to help them so they can drive this legislation forward and make it happen and give the American people what they want and what they're asking for.
Gil, I'm going to give the last word from us to Peter, and then we'll open it up. Peter?
Thanks. I guess the last question I want to ask is, you know, we've seen over the past few years a growing partisan divide between voters with and without college degrees. Mm-hmm. This has been, I think, most noticeable among, you know, the white electorate, but it's been something that's really clear in the you know, the polling over the past couple of years. And I think, you know, it's taking this to universities, you know, it's true that I think in terms of voting behavior, in terms of ideology, you know, the median employee of a college or university is more likely to be, you know, moderate to liberal, more likely to vote Democratic. I think that's a fair assessment nowadays for many reasons. But I think a lot of academics also feel like universities have been used as a kind of bludgeon in the culture wars, and that's kind of contributed to this, you know, this growing partisan divide and dispute over kind of the role of college and education. And I'm just wondering, you know, is this a shift you think that American higher education can help address and redress? Or is it something really kind of beyond our control? And to me, this is most salient when we think about, you know, the fact that academics spend their careers really trying to reach truth in their field, whether it's in public health, whether it's in studying the climate, whatever the area is. And they want to share what they've learned, and, you know, at least in their area of expertise. And it's very demoralizing when we end up getting demonized. So I was just wondering, in terms of kind of broader civic health, what do you make of this? And is there a role for universities to help address this?
Well, I look, I love academia. I think academia's mission is one of the most important things that we have, to seek knowledge. And as you say, right, seek out the truth and tell the story of the truth. And I think that's something that needs to be done. And I don't want to see, their mission change at all. And I think it's unfortunate that academia has kind of taken a hit and people, some people have criticized academia, especially saying, oh, it's these institutions of liberalism that are just creating these progressive people out there. But, a lot of these individuals that are saying that all went to, universities. They all have college degrees. Most of them probably have advanced degrees. And yet, it didn't change them. Universities should be about ideas, right? And like you said, seeking out the truth. That's why I put a lot of emphasis on research that comes from colleges rather than maybe something that might be done independently, because I think those, when it's done through academia, it's going to be more, seeking out the truth rather than being more partisan because it was paid for by certain individuals. So I don't want to see that change at all. I think academia needs to continue with their mission. But democracy is hard. And it's you can see that throughout the world, right? And it's the sad thing that I hate to see right now is that, a lot of people have kind of put their don't trust our universities. They don't trust our media. There's a lack of trust in these institutions, which are a very important part of democracy. My grandmother had a sixth grade education, but I consider she educated herself, right? She knew the issues. She would watch the news. She would read and kind of try to about current events and what was going on in the world. The sad thing, I think, of what we're hearing a lot right now, with there being so much, there are so many sources for information that are coming on right now that people have the access to with the internet. But a lot of it isn't accurate. A lot of it isn't true. A lot of it's misguided. And I think you're seeing people put a lot more emphasis and, importance on this type of information than the actual, vetted information through like academia and research or through, our news media. And, that I think has really caused a lot of the mistrust in the country where people don't believe things. I mean, I actually had a relative of mine tell me that, he doesn't watch the news. He doesn't read the newspaper. He gets all his information and all his news from social media. And I think that more than anything is hurt our democracy, and it's causing a lot of this partisanship that we're seeing right now.
Thanks.
Gil, I think I speak for everyone in this audience, I'm sure, that America needs you. We hope you get back in and win this thing next time around. But I think right now we're gonna open it up to the audience. For me, I'm gonna certainly walk away with a great quote. Democracy is hard. I think that is definitely a great one. But let's see, Jocelyn. I'm going to call on Jocelyn Clemmings, who from my office, who is really just a wizard, and we couldn't really do things without her. Jocelyn, would you mind managing our discussion for today?
Sure, of course. So the first question we have here is from Joaquin. He says, do you expect the event from January to become a much more common occurrence?
Oh, God, I hope not. you know, and our two history professors can correct me if I'm wrong here, but I just read, I'm a few years behind on my book, so I just read Doris Kearns Goodwin's book, you know, A Team of Rivals, and there was a part in there where she's talking about during, after Abraham Lincoln's election, when they were going to go count the electoral votes, they were worried then that the Capitol was going to be overrun, you know, and to prevent him from to prevent the electoral votes being counted so that he couldn't become president. And unfortunately, it didn't happen then. And I think, you know, now into this time and everything that's going on, how that happened, it's just crazy of the idea. And talking to my colleagues that are still there, it's just unbelievable what they're having to go through. I mean, you look at it, the Capitol now, and not just the Capitol, it's the whole surrounding area over there on Capitol Hill. All the office buildings are all surrounded by fences. You have, you know, military individuals that are there with M16s. You know, this is not the country that we know. And we need to get back to the area where we can, you know, people can have access to the Capitol, you know, on a friendly basis and go there and to be able to talk to their members of Congress. I hope not, you know, January 6th was an unfortunate time in our country's history. It is something that I never hope we see again. And I think if it becomes commonplace, then, you know, we're in deep trouble. But, you know, I have, you know, I have faith in our country, right? And I have faith in the American people. And I know that we can get back on track and we can, you know, hopefully President Biden will be, you know, somebody's there who's kind of been a middle of the ground guy, you know, his whole career that can bring both sides together so that we can find commonplace and work together to move the country forward.
Thank you. Thank you for that. We have one more question in the chat and then we only have you for 45 minutes today. So if anyone wants to throw in one more question, we may have time for it, but we'll start with Nathan's question. And that is, you mentioned the story that you told earlier that someone wouldn't vote for you because you were in the wrong party. Is that becoming more common today or less common and why?
You know, I think it's always kind of been there, but I think, you know, it might be happening more in larger numbers than maybe before. You know, you would always hear about individuals that were able to, even though the area they represented might be in a higher number of registered voters from a different party than they were, but they were still able to maintain this. You know, I think that's becoming harder and harder. You know, I don't want to say that it's never happened before. Will it never happen again? It definitely will. But we've gotten to this thing of where things have become so partisan, where the R or the D or whatever your party preference for some individuals has become more important than, you know, the actual, you know, individual that you're voting for. It's almost like we're headed towards a parliamentary system where you're voting for the party rather than for the individual. And, you know, and that's just not the way our system is set up. And I think when we kind of do that and go that way, it's not going to be the right way. You know, our system is set up about voting for those that are going to best serve their constituents. And that's something that we need to kind of, you know, take into account when we go vote, you know, into the ballot box. And you know, party preference shouldn't matter for us. Because I think if it does, if all we're doing is voting for the party, then it's not really going to matter who's there in Washington. And then you're just going to have the people in charge, you know, the leadership, whether it be the leadership in the House and leadership in the White House, that are making all the decisions, and everybody else just won't have a voice. And when you have the backbenchers there without a voice, then, you know, the American people lose their voice.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And I have 5:46, so I want to be respectful of your time. Provost Vincent, do you want to say some final words?
Certainly. I want to thank our audience for joining us today. Really appreciate your coming out. This concludes our program. I want to thank the Honorable Gil Cisneros, Professor Peter Schulman, the Cuyahoga County Public Library, the Case Western Reserve University College of Arts and Sciences, the Military Ethics Program for supporting today's event. And again, thank you so much for joining us in these North Star seminars. We have been on quite a journey, and we hope to continue this journey in the months to come. Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful evening.